It's good to see everyone this morning. Before we continue with our study, let's go to our Heavenly Father in a word of prayer. Dale, would you mind directing our minds in that prayer?
Our most loving Heavenly Father, we thank Thee so much for this day. We thank Thee for this privilege we have of being able to come together to study Thy Word, to be an encouragement to one another. We thank Thee, Father, for the many talents of this congregation. For the work that we do, we ask that You would be with us, that we might always give You the praise and the glory, that we might utilize the talents that You've given us. And we thank Thee, Father, for our upcoming gospel meeting and pray that it will be successful. We ask also, Father, that You'd be with our members who had physical ailments. We ask that You would be with our sister Vera Blackburn as she continues to recover from her surgery. And we ask that You'd be with our sister Betty Wilson as she continues with the treatments necessary to find what's ailing her. We ask also, Father, that You use us as Your instruments to reach out to them and help them and others of the congregation that, due to age and poor health, are not able to get out. We're thankful, Father, for John, for his willingness to study. We ask that You would be with him this morning, that he might be able to present those things that are necessary for our learning, for our spiritual growth, that we can continue to serve Thee and always give You the praise and the glory. These things we ask in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
All right, trust everyone is doing well today. It's off to a good start. Good morning.
Good morning.
Did you want to let them know about Matthew?
Actually, a couple things. Dale, do you want to take a minute and, for those who might not have seen the email, brief everyone on Sister Betty's current status?
Well, I can. Betty is back here in Edmond. And so if you get a chance to give her a call, I know she'd appreciate that. They did find some spots on her lung, and so she's going to have a biopsy on her lungs. She did not have to have a colonoscopy or anything like that. But
she will be able to.
What?
She's going to have to have one now that she's got here. They didn't do it back down there. But
well, they are going to do tests here, but they're going to do biopsy on that lung to find out what the spots are first. And that's all we know right now. Other than that, her electrolytes are back up to normal. And so right now, she's her happy-go-lucky self. But we need to keep her in our prayers.
Okay. Also, you know what happens when you have a couple kids playing on the playground and they have an odd collision? You get a femur broken.
Oh, really? That's not good.
You know, Rob Lundstrom's son, Matthew, broke his femur and just a freak collision out on the playground. And so he is having surgery right now. As of the last update, they weren't sure if he was going to be pins or rods that they put in to help it heal up. And he's at St. Francis Children's Hospital, which is in Tulsa, isn't it?
Right.
Okay. All right, it's in Tulsa.
He's 8, right?
I think so. Probably 8 years
his
old.
His birthday is the day they're here.
I think he said he was 8 years old.
So he'll be 9 the day they get here.
So, I haven't spoken with Rob yet. It's too early to see how this, if it will impact our meeting. I suspect we'll have to see whether or not he's able to travel. I mean, because it's less than just over a week away. And so we'll have to see how that impacts the meeting and everything. So we'll, but as we have more information, knowing Rob, he'll do his best to be here. But whether or not his whole family will come, I suspect will hinge on how Matthew's, once the leg is going to cast and how he's getting around and everything. So, but we'll keep everyone updated with that information. But be sure to keep both of them in your minds and in your prayers as well as others. All right. We are currently involved in a study of looking at the various blessed are statements found within the Bible. In a moment, we're going to step into lesson 2. For those who are viewing online, there is a link beneath the chat window where you can click and download a PDF copy of lesson number 2. If you want lesson number 1, you'll have to look back into the archive of last week's video and you'll see a link there for lesson 1 as well. But before we go into lesson number 2, let's look back to the last part of lesson number 1. We were looking at blessed are those who trust in the Lord. And the assignment was list some Bible examples of those who trusted in the Lord. Now, they just don't throw out a list of faithful Bible characters. There's a lot of them. But the thing about the biblical story, what are some of the characters known for the decisions they made, decisions that were clearly based upon their trust in God? Let's take a stab at it. What's that?
Abraham.
Yeah, Abraham's a good example. Whether we're looking at when God called him to go into the land of Canaan, or where God said, sacrifice yourself. You know. Oftentimes, as we talked about last week's study, we think of faith as being a conviction or a persuasion, but that underlies ultimately a trust. And that's what we're looking at, trusting in God. Biblical examples.
Noah.
All right. All right, let's start. Did you go through Hebrews 11? Well, that's right in the Bible text, so that's right. Noah was mentioned. Okay.
Ruth.
All right. Who else? Someone said.
Paul.
Okay, Paul saw. Who'd you say, Pat?
Melchizedek.
Okay. Good one. Who said Joseph a while ago? Right, okay, I heard Joseph. And Joseph is another one of those where his life took a bad turn, for lack of a better way of putting it. And what did he do? He trusted in God to deliver.
And in the end, he says, God brought me here so that I could save my family. And I think, and our kids just studied that on Sunday, and the fact that even when you're going through bad times, if we can look to find something good in it, it helps us bear through them.
That's right. That's right. Any other examples?
Sounds like Esther.
Okay, Ezra.
Esther.
Esther.
She
Sorry.
Was put
for such a time as this.
You said Hezekiah. Mm-hmm. Okay, and what example of Hezekiah?
Well, it just says word for word in 2 Kings. He trusted in the Lord, so that there was no king like him before or after him.
Okay, all right.
So, I mean, but as far as examples, he tore down things that even David and Joshua hadn't torn down, as far as things that the people had burned incense to.
The high place.
So, he definitely put his trust in the Lord.
All right, there's something else about Hezekiah. Memory serves, wasn't he on death's door? Mm-hmm. And the Lord granted him 15 years? 15, yeah. Missiles?
He had the servant with the camel. I think his name is Eliezer. Sent to fetch a wife for Isaac.
Oh, Abraham's servant. Yeah, Eliezer. Yeah, that's right. And think about the trust he had. Trust in that he had in God. Any other examples?
I put Naomi with Ruth.
Oh, that's right. Because Naomi, although she lost everything, Ruth stayed by her side, and Naomi remained faithful to God and was taken care of. That's a good point.
It was the trust in God that Naomi had, not Ruth.
Oh, that's right. Because Ruth was a Moabite. Okay, good example. In the case of Paul, I think Ms. Florence mentioned Paul. What really strikes me there with him, there are a couple things, obviously, how much the Lord forgave Paul from Paul's mindset and everything. But also consider, though, even when he prayed about the thorn in the flesh, he trusted in God enough that when God said, my grace is sufficient for thee, Paul's content. All right. So appreciate all the participation and work with that. Let's go ahead and look at lesson number 2. Lesson number 2. This one we're going to be looking at. Blessed are those who obey the Lord. Blessed are those who obey the Lord. What was interesting about this study, the development of it, there are going to be some of the subject matters we look at that there are, such as this one, 4 or 5 different blessed are statements found throughout the scriptures. But then there are going to be others, like lesson number 4, when we talk about blessed are those who repent and are forgiven, well, there's really only one verse that kind of structures it in that phrase, blessed are those who. And so some of the lessons will have less material establishing the principle and take a longer look at the blessed are statements. And then other lessons will have to have more material establishing the point, and then we use the one blessed are statement. So it's interesting to see how these develop. So let's go ahead and take a look. The principle of obedience unto God. What we find is that, of course, as Christians, it is a part of every true follower of God. I mean, an individual might be able to say, hey, guess what? I trust in the Lord. But in the reality, if he doesn't obey God, he doesn't trust in the Lord. And so, blessed are those who obey the Lord. Let's think about Deuteronomy chapter 6. Where did this first principle, or I should say, with whom did this first principle of obedience after Adam and Eve? Yeah. Think about this. Where did it really begin? As far as where God finally began to say to people, here's my law, here's what I want you to do. If you'll do this, I'll bless you. And if you don't, I'll curse you. Pardon me? Well, yes, yes. I never thought about Abraham. What is missing from the life of Abraham in regards to what God tells Abraham and comparing it to the children of Israel? Abraham's a very interesting example. I hadn't thought about that. What did God not...
There's not really any curses. He's like,
yeah.
Because the Israelites, he says, if you don't, I will do this. But, you know, Abraham, he didn't say, if you don't go to Canaan, I'm going to, you know...
Exactly.
He went as soon as God unbelieved.
He did.
Exactly what God wanted him to do.
Yeah.
And never questioned him.
He did. And so, therefore, in the covenant that God made with Abraham, there's nowhere where God said, now, if you don't do this... So what makes that different from the children of Israel's covenant established on Mount Sinai is that it was not a fulfillment of the covenant that God made with Abraham. And you think about it, that covenant, it was going to be an everlasting covenant that was established upon God's word with Abraham. And so we come to Mount Sinai, and we see what happens with the first generation of Israelites. And so they're about to enter into the promised land. We have Moses making the covenant, if you would, again with the second generation. And notice what he says here, and I'll bring it up on the screen there behind me, Deuteronomy chapter 6. And let's turn over there for a moment and begin our reading in verse 10. And we'll read Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 10 through 19. Let's see. Miss Pat, would you mind reading verses 10 and 11 for us, please?
So it shall be when the Lord your God brings you into the land of which he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you large and beautiful cities which you did not build, houses full of good things which you did not fill, hewn out wells which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees which you did not plant. And you have eaten and are full. Then beware lest ye forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage.
All right, so we'll pause there for a moment. It's interesting that here's his warning. After you go into the land and the Lord gives you everything, it's basically what it boils down to. All your needs are provided. And really, it's not just all your needs are provided, but provided in abundance. You know, everything you could possibly need, you're going to have. Every tree you want to need will be there. The cisterns, the wells, all those things will now be yours. But notice what he warns them of here in verse 12. He says, lest you forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. That almost seems pretty typical, doesn't it? And this is a very generalized statement, I realize that. But oftentimes, when you think of children, the more you give them, the more you provide for them, and we're not talking about where they do chores and so forth, but where you just openly give everything to them, they tend not to appreciate it. They tend not to be thankful for that. And this was the warning about the children of Israel, because what's going to happen, they're going to get into the land, and they're going to sit back and become lazy and take for granted everything that they have and forget the Lord. Yes, Travis.
Well, that's what it said at the end of verse 10. It says, great and good cities that you did not build, you know.
Yeah.
That, you know, you didn't build these. All you got to do is go in and take them. like you said, and then they just sit there and enjoy it. The wells that were already dug and everything.
Yeah. I mean, it was going to be truly the promised land when you think about that. So he warns them not to forget him. All right, let's continue reading here in verse 13, and let's see. Miss Maxine, would you read for us verses 13 through 15, please?
You shall fear the Lord your God and serve him, and shall take oaths in his name. You shall not go after other gods, the gods of the people who are all around you. For the Lord your God is a jealous God among you, lest the anger of the Lord your God be aroused against you and destroy you from the face of the earth.
All right, and let's see. Ms. Beth, would you like to continue reading 16 through, let's go and finish up through 19, please.
You shall not put the Lord your God to the test as you tested him at Massah. You should diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God and his testimonies and his statutes, which he has commanded you. You shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with you, and that you may go in and possess the good land which the Lord swore to give your fathers, by driving out all your enemies from before you, as the Lord has spoken.
Okay, thank you. So what we see here with this text is the ongoing promise that if you will do this, and you'll do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, then all will be well. But if you forget the Lord and turn to other gods, then he will withdraw all that which he's given to him. And to me, what I've often found interesting when you look at, especially Leviticus kind of talks the same thing, you know, within the promise there. But when you look at some of what Deuteronomy contains regarding blessings and cursings, it's almost, I'd say it's prophetical. Because sure enough, the things that he sketched out that would happen did happen. And it wasn't that he was saying, you have to do this. But, and I think it might be Deuteronomy 12, but it slipped my mind. We looked at it a couple weeks ago, I think, in a sermon maybe a month back, where he walks through there, and ultimately he says, you'll disobey me. If you disobey me, I'll punish you. You'll repent, I'll punish you, I'll repent. But eventually, you're going to go so far. I think three different times here, and the third time, maybe fourth time, he says, you'll go to another land. And someone else will have control over you. And like I said, I call it prophetical, only in that he sketched out everything that would happen. And he fulfilled his side of it when they disobeyed him. All right, any thoughts? Yes.
You know what they're talking about when he makes a reference to testing him at Massa?
Oh,
I didn't recognize that.
Exodus 17, chapter, verses 1 through 7.
Okay.
Exodus 17?
Verses 1 through 7.
Let's see. All right. No water for drink to the people. This one, when they cry out to the Lord. And let's see, what was the main...
Basically, their question was, is the Lord among us or not?
Yeah.
They were questioning his presence.
And this was really one of the first instances of their complaining after having been saved. And you'll notice here is when the Lord told Moses to take in your hand your rod with it, the one that you struck the river, and go, and behold, I'll stand before thee on the rock of Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it, that the people may drink it. And so therein is the testing reference, or at least what Dale was, from the footnote there, pointing us to. Look at verse 7 there. So he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the contention of the children of Israel there. Yeah. Appreciate that, Dale. Thank you. And you know, think about that, that's a fundamental point. And 40 years earlier, roughly 40 years earlier is when this event happened. But it remained within their history. They remembered it, maybe their parents talked about it. It was when the children of Israel were contentious with the Lord. Any thoughts?
This is kind of the same thing he's saying here in Deuteronomy 6 chapter, when we began at verse 10. He said, I gave you these things, but you did not do it.
Yes.
You did not build the houses. You did not do this. You did not do this. But I gave it to you. Right. And this goes all the way back to Exodus there, because what they were doing is they were doubting God's kindness. And so he's reminding them again of the kindness that he provides to us.
Right. And when we forget the kindness, we begin to doubt. Any other thoughts or comments? All right, let's see. Jumping now back to the outline, let me jump back to the chart here. So to the next point there, Jesus established the same principles, nothing new. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 27, he makes the point there that not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Now, the thing is, there were going to be people who would say, Lord, Lord, look at all the things we've done. Have we not cast out demons? Have we not prophesied? Have we not done this and that? But he'll say to them in the text there, I never knew you, because they were workers of iniquity. They didn't do the will of God. What is the great parable there found in Matthew 7, 21 through 27, that so easily and readily illustrates the principle of obedience?
We have the house on the rock.
Yeah. Sing the song for us.
I can't remember it. It's been too long.
You know, the wise man built his house upon the rock. Yeah.
But it's kind of a, I guess, understood that there was obedience involved, because it doesn't really say, do this or your house will be flooded, I guess. Right.
Right.
It's more the principle of building it on that.
Yeah. It's one of those cases where it's not so much a blessing and a cursing. It's just a simple example. You know, if you obey, then you're going to be like this guy who builds his house upon a rock. I don't know. Anyway, the rock is actually farther in the ground, and there's a lot of dirt, kind of a dead rock you might think about, I guess. But anyway, but then if you don't obey, then you're going to be the man that builds his house on the sand. Don't ever play Pictionary with me. I'm not good at all. But isn't that a simple principle? You know, it's so simple. If you hear the will of the Lord and do it, you're the man, you're the wise man. You've made a wise choice. But if you hear the word of the Lord and don't do it, then you're a foolish man. You made a foolish choice. Not quite as dramatic as the third Indiana Jones movie, where the guy says, you've chosen wisely. But understand the point, though. It is so simple. Children of Israel, we see it within them time and time again. Within what Jesus taught, we see this principle time and time again. Where does our obedience to the Lord begin? It begins in the heart. Let's turn over there to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. And let's see, Miss Brenda, would you mind reading for us verses 15 through 17, please?
What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? May it never be. Do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness? But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed.
All right, thank you. Now, again, the principle here is just as simple as the parable of the wise man who built his house upon the sand. But look at what the text says again. He says in verse 16, here you go, he says, do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one's slave. So if I'm going to present, if you're going to present yourself as a slave unto righteousness, then you're going to do righteously. But if you present yourself as a slave unto sin, then the end result of that is going to be death or separation from God. Simple concept. And I know that with our study, as we go through the study, we are establishing a lot of very fundamental principles that we've all learned all of our lives, but yet it's like why we take vitamins every day. You know, if you take vitamins, You know, it's some basic building blocks that we always have to be reminded of, because like Israel, if we're not careful, we can forget. So he says in verse 17 that these folks here in Rome, these Christians, were not slaves of sin, but instead they obeyed from where? That former doctrine. Exactly, yeah. They obeyed from the heart that former doctrine. Although the Lord never really told Israel to obey from the heart, he said, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and mind. You know, and I think we've mentioned this before. When I, oftentimes in growing up, and especially when I first started preaching, the tendency would be to describe the Mosaic law as all physical and the law of Christ all spiritual. But in reality, that's not the case. Now, there were a lot more ordinances that bound them that they had to observe, all the way down to what they could eat and what they could not eat, how to take care of themselves after they touched a dead body. I mean, so many different ordinances. But it's still, their true obedience needed to come from the heart. Same thing for us today. There are certain ordinances that we have to observe. And if we obey from the heart, then we will. And obedience would be second nature to us. Any thoughts?
With this analogy of the slave and master, it makes sense why Jesus said, you know, no one can serve two masters. You can say you're serving God, but if you're not obeying him, then this is what Paul's saying. You're the master of who you obey. So yep. If you're not obeying God, then he can't be your master.
That's right. Exactly right. Simple concept. That's right. All right, any other thoughts? All right, let's see. The last verse we're going to look at before we look at the blessed are statements is found in Hebrews chapter 5. Look here what this has to say, verses 7 through 11, in regards to obedience. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7 there. Let's see. Jimmy, read for us, if you would, verses 7 and 8.
Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and was heard because of his godly fears. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered.
All right, and then let's see. Travis, read for us verses 9. Let's go ahead and read 9 through 11 here.
And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Called by God as high priest, according to the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have much to say and hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing.
Okay. Now, look earlier here. I have in the outline that to obey is to follow in the steps of Christ. And I need to go back for just a moment. I won't do it right now. I may have called the wrong chapter here within this. But we can make what we've read here fit if it's not what I had in mind. When we think about Jesus, he had offered up prayers and supplication for him with cries and tears to him who was able to save him from the dead. He was heard because of his godly fear. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. And having been perfected, he became what?
The author of eternal salvation.
Yeah, the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Now, we're going to take just a moment here, and there's a reason why I use the word footsteps within our text. And let's see if I can find out why I did that. No, not there. Okay, just sounded good, didn't it?
There's a song, Footsteps of Jesus.
That must be it. I'm going to go back and look at it. I'm double-checking the text here that I put down. But for us, though, and for our time, what we're looking at here today, he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. So can we learn obedience? Oh, we have to learn obedience, don't we? Now, the thing about Jesus, what differentiates us from Jesus is that the best way to understand this statement here about Jesus, and this is for me the answer, or at least one way of looking at it, is that through all eternity, since before the beginning, he had always been there with, as we understand it, God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. Through him all things were made that was made, John chapter 1 says. So we believe in his deity and the eternal nature of Jesus. But throughout all that, we presume or we assume that he never faced an instance of where he had to choose between doing the will of God, the Father, and not doing his will. And it could be that throughout all eternity, the equality of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, as we understand it, the equality there never even presented an opportunity of going against. And I think that's a reasonable assumption there, because Jesus was God. However, when he came to this earth and lived in a body, he had to make choices. He had to make decisions. Now, I think we can say on one hand, Jesus could not sin. And I say that because what was at stake, there was no way possible he was going to choose to go against his Father. But it still was his choice. And so it may be that within that context, he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. Because the things that he suffered, he did so because of the will of his Father. Because he chose to abide by his Father's will. And therefore sets an example for us today. All right, any thoughts, any comments? Yes, Jim.
In our believing God or service to God, there must be a willingness to obey. That's the change in mind, change of heart, change of attitude that creates that willingness rather than questioning. And if there's a willingness to obey.
Right.
And that's the principle that we have to follow.
That's right. There's got to be that willingness there. Any other thoughts or comments about that? Ms. Pat?
We must suffer reproaches and problems just to follow Christ, because we don't blend in to the world and shouldn't.
That's right.
We should stand. We should be a light.
And that goes back to our statement there. That's how we learn obedience.
It is. Because it's not natural. I mean, not always is it natural to humble yourself and do what the Lord teaches you to do.
Well,
not always easy.
Well, that's the thing. When it is easy, it's easy. But when it's difficult, that's when the test comes in.
It's easy around God's people.
Yeah. You think about it for a moment. It's kind of as an example. If you're going to install, let's say, an electrical line within your house, you have to consider the amount of load that's going to be put on that wire. So, for instance, If you take wires and if you were to take apart your radio, you're going to find a real thin wire that goes through there. That real thin wire is only designed to carry a certain amount of current, real, real low. But let's say if you take that wire and you hook it up and try to run your dryer off of that wire, use that gauge, what was it, like 16 or 18 gauge, Travis, on that small level. If you try to run your dryer off of it, the wire's going to melt. It's going to get too hot, and then it's going to melt, and it's going to cause a fire. And so you have to go off the right gauge of wire, depending on what you're doing. Because the more electricity it throws through it, it's got to handle it, or else it'll overheat, and it'll start a fire. Well, that's what I'm talking about, Pat. There are certain decisions within our lives that'll be easy. But then there are the hard ones. And that's when really what we're made of is proven. And that's where we learn the hard lessons of what obedience. And oftentimes we may fail. We may fall under the pressure the first time we hit that temptation. But then we repent, improve, and we can tackle it again. And maybe that's, although Jesus never sinned, we could in the same way learn obedience. Any thoughts or comments?
He could have sinned. But he would have been separated from God, and that's the one thing that would have broke his heart. He could not bear to be separated from his Father.
Yeah. That's why I have to be very careful in saying that Jesus could not sin because of what was at stake. He wasn't going to. But yet, we have to be careful. If we say that Jesus could not sin, then it makes our ability to overcome sin impossible. And there's a huge debate about this about 15 years ago.
I think it must be the worst thing in the world to be separated from God, because Christ could not bear that. That's the only time he really, when he was on the cross, that was the time he couldn't bear. It was the hardest for him. He didn't dread the cross as much as he dreaded knowing he'd be separated from his Father. Sin separated him.
And that's a whole nother debate.
Yeah, okay. I'll quit. I give.
No, and we won't. I mean, it is an interesting study when you look at Jesus' statement of Psalms 22. Why have you forsaken me?
Because he took on the world's sin.
Okay, but when you look at Psalms 22 and you read that's what the quote is from. Mm-hmm. When you read Psalms 22 all the way to the end, the psalmist realizes that you didn't forsake me. And so the people standing there hearing that would have known that psalm and likely realized it was a psalm of victory. So I know it's interesting to hear both sides of that debate. And for years, I mean, I remember one preacher, you know, standing up and very emphatically in a sermon saying that, you know, here, imagine Jesus all alone, even the Father he'd been with for eternity, absent from him. I mean, it sounds like a good appeal, you know, to make. But there's a lot of questions that come up as a result of that. So, we'll look at that later. But this is about obedience. Any other thoughts or comments? Okay. So, let's go to the blessed R's. There's the one. I didn't bring that. Let me share that with the folks at home for just a moment. That was Hebrews 5:7-11 is what we read, following in the footsteps of Jesus. All right, let's look at the Blessed Are passages for a moment. The first one is Psalms 119, verse 1. Psalms 119, verse 1. So let's take a moment. We will turn in our Bibles to that text there, and we'll look at it. We need to be Psalms 119. Notice here the psalmist. He says here, blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk how? In the law of the Lord. Now, the idea of walking in the law of the Lord is referencing the manner of a person's life, the way that a person lives. And so the psalmist declares here, blessed are the undefiled in the way. The individuals who are willing to serve God and walk in the way of the Lord, to remain undefiled, to remain consecrated unto the Lord, those individuals would be blessed in all that they would do. Again, think about the example of the children of Israel. How blessed they would be, how much the Lord would have provided for them and taken care of them. Same thing for us today. Let's turn to one passage. Look over in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15. Through 16 here.
Before you move off of that, verse 2, when we were talking about the heart, that's exactly what happens. You seek him with the whole heart, entirety.
That's a good point. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart. And really, when you look at this, I probably should have grouped. Verse 2 with it. I had to go back to my outline there.
Probably should have also added Psalms 128, verse 1.
There's a lot of them. There's a lot of them. That's right. Why don't you go ahead and read for us Psalms 28, verse 1, and then we'll come back to the...
It's 128,
verse
1.
128,
verse
1.
Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways.
Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord. Who walks in his ways. All right, and that's the concept here of what we're looking at here. Let's continue with the verse 2 here, statement there. And notice, as Brenda pointed out, blessed are those who keep his testimonies, and blessed are those who do what with their whole heart?
Seek.
Seek him.
Yeah.
Isaiah chapter 55, verse 6. Let's look there for a moment as kind of a cross-reference to this. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 6. Isaiah writes, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. We have to understand that as Christians, as children of God, if we are going to be blessed in our lives as Christians, then we have to seek him and we have to keep the testimonies that he's given to us. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, what does the Lord tell us to seek first? Yeah, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all these things will be added unto you. Seek first the kingdom of God. Any thoughts or comments about this? Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek with a whole heart. Turn now over to Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 32. This is the next one. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 32. We read here within the text, "Now therefore listen to me, my children, for blessed are those who do what? Who keep my ways." Now, this is an interesting statement. There are times you have to be very careful when you go looking for specific Bible verses. I've got a Bible, they call it a Bible, but I've got this book in my office called Knave's Topical Bible. And it's really good. If you want to find verses on righteousness, turn to righteousness. It gives you all the Bible verses. The problem is, sometimes they will put a verse within a topical heading that contextually it doesn't quite fit. But this one right here, let's turn over there to Proverbs chapter 8, and let's look at that context here for just a moment. In the beginning of this text here, in verse 1 of Proverbs 8, notice the way he begins this. "Does not wisdom cry out, and understanding lift up her voice?" So who's the subject matter of this particular area we're looking at? Wisdom, okay? Wisdom is a personification of wisdom, if you would. "Does not wisdom cry out, and understanding lift up her voice?" Look at verse 12. Again, we see, "I, wisdom, dwell with prudence and find out knowledge and discretion." So with this beginning here, we see a statement being made by wisdom, putting a personification to it. And so starting here with verse 12, he says, "I, wisdom, dwell with prudence and find out knowledge and discretion." So then we're going to slowly scroll through this here. You'll notice verse 14, "Counsel is mine." This is what wisdom is saying. "By me kings reign." Verse 16, "By me princes rule and nobles and all the judges of the earth." All right, continue reading there. He says, "I love those who love me. Riches and honor are with me." Verse 18. So let's come on down, following there. Then in verse 22, "The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his way, before his works of old." Following on down, "While as yet he had not made the earth or the fields or the primalness of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there," says wisdom. So then we come down to verse 32. "Now therefore listen to me, my children." This is wisdom talking. "For blessed are those who keep my way." Any thoughts or any comments about that? "For blessed are those who do what? Keep my ways." The ways of wisdom, the ways of knowledge, the ways of understanding. And these ways that we are looking at comes from the Word of God. We have a comment in the chat room that I just noticed, so let's bring it up here for just a moment. Randy says, "It is all about God in this world and in the world to come. It is all about God. He is our everything." I mean, that's what the knowledge and the wisdom and our obedience revolves around. It's all about him. "Blessed is the man who," and this is what we're looking at, "the one that obeys, the one that follows, the one that listens to the wisdom thereof." All right, any thoughts or any comments?
You know, when we're chosen to love him with all of our heart, mind, and body.
That's right.
It includes wisdom.
That's right. That's exactly right. Ms. Brittany?
I was just going to say, going down to verse 34, where it says,
Blessed is the man who listens to me. And then 35 says, he who finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord.
That's right. There's so much here within this text that really exemplifies the importance of wisdom within our life. And if we put the simple English word of happy instead of blessed, this makes even more sense. You know, happy is our life if we find favor with the Lord, if we watch daily at the gate, if we listen to wisdom, if we wait at the post of the doors, if you would. Kind of like an eager student. And this is kind of a rambling secondary thought, but you think about in chapters 6 and 7, go back, of Proverbs, he talks about essentially the prostitute, the woman who would attract and lure away and deceive the idiot, kind of is the idea there, the simple man without understanding. And then you turn it over, and instead of waiting at the door of the harlot, be the one that waits at the door of wisdom. And choose just to learn from that and to overcome the desires of the world. All right. Any thoughts? All right, let's take a moment now and let's look at our last blessed R from this text. This one comes from Luke chapter 11, verse 28. We'll read it first here, Luke 11, verse 28. But he said, "More than that, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it." Now, this context is very interesting, so let's turn over there. Luke chapter 11, verse 28. Don't go too far. There we go. Luke chapter 11, verse 28. There's the verse that we just read. But if you back up to it, someone thinks that they are going to offer to Jesus a blessing that is very worthy. And it happened as he spoke these things that a certain woman from the crowd raised her voice and said to him, "Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breast which nursed you." Now, I wouldn't suggest hollering this out if you go to the Trump rally that's coming around, because people of today may not take that quite the same. But it was a blessing offered back then because the woman knew how great Jesus was. So imagine the womb that bore you. Happy is that womb that brought you into the world. Happy are the breasts which nursed you. Acknowledging the greatness of Jesus. But yet, look what Jesus said in verse 28. More than that, blessed or happy are those who what? Who hear the word of God and keep it. And what it does, and in one statement here, Jesus takes the focus off of Mary and puts it on the word. Takes the focus off his physical body and puts it to the word of God, and the importance of keeping it. All right, any thoughts or comments? Yes, Jim.
The word here is not a simple word, particularly in this verse, because it has a subsequent or a continuing meaning that is not limited to audiology. It's not just hear and listen, but it's hear, believe, accept, and do.
Right.
That's right. That's the definition of the word here, as used here, H-U-R-E.
James 1:28 goes along with what Gene's saying there, or 1:25 rather.
Mm-hmm. Let's look at that for a moment. James chapter 1, verse
25.
Go ahead and read that, Dell, if you would.
But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does.
Exactly, yeah.
And not a hearer only.
That's right, not a hearer only. There is a, and I have forgotten where it's at right offhand, but Jesus, he poses the question, a man has two sons. And he says to one, go do this. And the son says, I will. But he doesn't. And the other son says, no. But yet he ended up doing it. Which one did the will of his father? Well, the second one did. You know, it's not important that a person says, yes, I'll do it. That's meaningless. What is important is whether or not they do it. That's what Gene's talking about. And oftentimes we think about words, Gene mentioned the word here within this context, and as Dale pointed out, James 1:25 supports that concept there. But think about the word receive. Receive the word of the Lord. You know, you receive it, you accept it. It's that idea, and all this yields the obedience for which we are going to be blessed. And not going to be blessed, but are blessed, if you think about it. Any other thoughts? History.
There's a kind of a parallel thought where we're told to put on the Christian armor. The substance of that is not that you put it on as a piece of clothing, but as your life.
Right.
That's to put on there. And the same thing goes with our life as Christians. We're to put on Christ. That means to make him a singular, complete part of our life. Put him on.
That's right. It might help us. Let me add to this right here. That instead of thinking about the New Testament as containing rules to live by, or even commands, I mean, that is properly used, commands. What if we were instead to view it as a standard to live by? It's easy enough to follow the rules.
Or principle.
Yeah, or principle, exactly. It's easy enough to follow the rules, but when we live by the standard, that goes beyond simply rule-keeping to even the very way that we think, the way that we live our lives. The moral excellence, the moral compass being so established that it's not about simply doing, it's about living, if that makes sense. I mean, I have known Christians who would go through the motions, but yet years later fall away. And it makes you wonder, were they simply going through the motions, or were they living by the standard? Were they living, serving the Lord with all the heart, soul, mind, and strength, obeying from the heart that form of doctrine? All right, any thoughts or comments about that? All right, we've got just a couple of minutes remaining. What's interesting is these lessons are a lot different than our Daniel study, our Ezra study, our Esther study. And it is interesting trying to build them off the blessed are statements, because as I said, you'll have few, you'll have some. And so what I did is I basically looked up blessed are and made a list of the verses, not exhaustively, and then went through and grouped them. And it was interesting, the groupings, you know, the one about repentance, the one about blessedness, but obedience. The fourth lesson, I still have to finish up before we distribute it, is going to be based on one verse. Blessed are those who wait on the Lord. And it's going to be a lesson of endurance, of patience, and perseverance. But before we close our study today, look at the kind of the assignment there. List some Bible examples of those blessed because of their obedience. What would be an example? Who would be an example of someone that you look within their life and you see blessings that came about as a result of their obedience?
Job.
All right, Job. All right, Job is a good example. Yeah, Job, very good. Who did you say?
Samuel.
Okay. The
Lord calling.
That's an important point. Yeah. And he ended up serving as a priest and a judge over Israel until the appointment of a king. Okay. Job, what's interesting about Job is how thoroughly he was blessed after his faithfulness.
More so than he was before.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right.
Abraham would be a pretty prominent one that comes to mind.
That's true.
But I guess specifically those after him would be blessed.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Well, even he was himself.
Yeah, he was too. That's yeah. true.
With the land, the children. Mm-hmm. And even when Sarah died, he married Keturah and still had children from her. That's why he lived to be 175 years. You got to live that long to fit two lifetimes in, I guess. And he was 100 when Isaac was born. I can't remember how old Sarah was when she died. Yeah.
I tells think. Us.
I thought it did. But so he only lived 65 years with Keturah, if you think about it, you know, but still had a whole nother life. Miss Pat, you had your hand up.
I think of how brave the Virgin Mary was and Joseph and their walk with God of, you know, just holding true, realizing that she's pregnant. Those times were, you just didn't do things like that. It wasn't acceptable.
Right.
And she changed her life immediately and accepted. Of course, she did see an angel, but still, I just think she had an awful lot of faith, her and Joseph.
All right.
127.
Good point. What's that, brother?
127.
So she was 127 when she died.
Wow.
Wow, that means Abraham would have been 137. So he was only with, well, yeah, he was only with Keturah for 32 years or?
Only? Most marriages don't last that long.
All right. Any other examples?
Daniel.
Very good point. Very good point. Because he was blessed by the king, or the Lord blessed him through the king there. I think about Joseph. Another one. And more, his family was blessed because of what he did. Yes, Ms. Pat.
The poor man and the rich man and the poor man example.
Lazarus. Oh, that's a good point. And the rich man and Lazarus. Yeah. Lazarus was blessed to go into Abraham's bosom. When he didn't have anything on this earth, he ultimately was blessed with that. And that's what we long to be blessed with, eternity with God in heaven. Any other thoughts or comments? Any other examples?
More of a general statement. It's the idea that the response is, "Hear my Lord, send thee."
That's a good point. Here I am, Lord, send me.
Lord, send
yeah.
thee.
Yeah. And what we really didn't talk about in this lesson, but I guess you know if we were to go in it deeper, is kind of ask ourselves, how are we blessed when we obey the Lord? You know, we always think about the spiritual blessings of eternity in heaven, but there are certain blessings that fall upon those who make right decisions, you know, who faithfully follow God. But ultimately, it's the spiritual blessings that abounds most. All right, any other thoughts?
What about Moses? Just curiosity. I mean, I would say that he went to God and lived in righteousness, even though he had that one major sin. That he was blessed, even so. Maybe not as much as he would have been had he not, but he was still blessed.
Moses is a case in point, I think, that emphasizes the spiritual blessings. Because he asked the Lord, and this is something that we'll look at in our prayer study, when the Lord says no. There's a case in point where Moses says to the Lord about the promised land, you know, putting in our, I really want to go. You know, let me go into the promised land. And the Lord says, I'll hear nothing more of this. You know, just very blunt with Moses. But yet Moses did enter the promised land. He did enter into eternity with God in heaven. So while he was deprived the ultimate blessing in his mind of the promised land, he still received the greater blessing. It's a good point.
But he did obey God even after that sin.
Mm-hmm.
He continued to lead the children. God told him that he would allow him to look into the promised land. He just couldn't go into it. So there was something for Moses to look forward to. Not only being able to look into what he was leading the Israelites to,
right,
but also the spiritual realm as well by continued
yeah.
obedience.
And you know, and he can look at it from the standpoint of the people will get that. Not that's what I'm missing. You know, depending on how you look at it, I would think that the former. Randy in the chat room says, blessed are those who believe in Jesus because of the words of the apostles. And ultimately, that's what we're longing for. One little side note, Pat, you brought this to mind, and I'll mention it here real quick. there was a movie a number of years ago called Nativity Thing, and it was a story about Mary and Joseph and everything. And it was a very interesting movie. It wasn't like, there's been some other religious movies that just was really, really off key when it comes to scriptures. But one of the things that struck me about that movie was very interesting. Imagine living in a Jewish town that was very strict upon the scriptures.
And everybody knew you.
Everybody knew you. And here you are engaged to a man and you're pregnant with a child. The movie depicted the amount of, depicted a great amount of scorn.
Yes.
That. Even when they were riding out of the town on the donkey, there were people hollering at them and glad they were leaving. And of course, you know, Joseph says something witty and funny like, something like, I bet they'll really miss us, you know. But anyway, the point is though, think about what she had to go through. I mean, in our day and time, that's not that big a deal.
No.
Unless you're raised right.
But Joseph absolutely had to face the same scorn that she did, because it was on him that he must have got her pregnant. So, you know, it was a very scornful thing.
If not, put her away.
Yes.
If you're not father of the child, get rid of her.
Exactly. Yeah. He caused himself to look even.
All right. Well, let's continue. Does everyone have a copy of Lesson 3? I think we just read it. Most everybody. Remind me afterwards, I'll give you a copy of Lesson 3. And then we'll look at that. All right, appreciate everyone coming. Appreciate those who have joined us on the chat room and who are online this morning. Let's go ahead and be dismissed. Before we do that, one more thing. Sorry, Michaela. This is next week's lesson. Blessed are those who repent and are forgiven. Travis, would you mind dismissing us in word of prayer?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and this time that we have to come here and to study another portion of your word. And we thank you for that ability that we have, that we can look at your word and get from it the things that we are to live by and that we can apply to our lives, that we can ultimately reach that goal of a home in heaven with you. Thank you for your son and his sacrifice for us that provides us that way. Through his blood being washed in it, we can have that way to salvation. We are also mindful of those of our number who may be sick. We ask that you please be with them and be with those that may be recovering from surgeries and tests. And we pray that you please help them to regain their strength and continue to remain steadfast and trustful in you. We ask that you please be with us here and please be with us as we leave here and with us on the road as our travel. And we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.